Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Miguel de Icaza, CTO and co-founder Xamarin.
Hello. So this presentation I'm going to do without a laptop. Welcome to What is New in Xamarin.iOS. I'm going to talk a little bit about the features that we added in the last year. I'm going to touch on a few things that I think you guys should know, because you might have missed it. We made a lot of upgrades that were all incremental. And many of these incremental updates you might have missed, and it might help you improve the quality of your applications, and it may improve the quality of your source code as well. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. I'm going to using that little sign, the one that says released, and it means you can use that today. It's been out there, and you can start using it now. Then I'm going to talk. There is a lot of stuff that I'm going to be talking about that involves the beta. The beta, like I mentioned this morning, is based on the Mono 3.0 development stack. It contains our new garbage collector, it contains the new .NET 4.5 APIs, and it contains a lot of new things that we added to the Monotouch line of products. It says beta, and you can get that stuff today from our beta channel. So if you're going to Xamarin Studio, if you're going to Visual Studio, you update your stack to the beta channel, this is everything you're going to get. The plan for the beta is to keep it around for about 2 months, something like that, while we iron out the last few details. We think it's stable enough that you can use that in production. If you go through QA and you test your application, you're good to go. We just want to make the experience a bit perfect before we upgrade the whole stack to the beta. So let's get started. As you guys know, this year we released our support for Visual Studio. We're very, very excited about that. But we already talked about that in the keynote. And this is available already in our release version. On our beta, we added F# support. We also touched on that on the keynote. And the idea is, you get fewer bugs, you get to reuse, you get to write less lines of code, and you get to continue to use all of your libraries from C#. Or if you choose to just build your libraries in F# and then build a UI in C#, you can do that. So let's talk about a few things that we've been doing in the last year about size reductions. We've been working to actually make your application smaller and smaller and smaller. For the samples that I'm going to show you today, I'm going to use my application, TweetStation, was a reference app that we use to check these things. We use TweetStation just because it's been around for a very long time. And the other benefit is that the source code for TweetStation has not really changed in 2 years, mostly because I haven't had time to work on a Twitter client. For those of you that don't know, TweetStation is the only Twitter client that elevates the discourse. And it does that by introducing chicken noises and a mischievous soundtrack for when you're writing a tweet. So whenever you're tempted to insult somebody on Twitter, the idea, the working idea at the time was, we'll use some mischievous music, so instead of insulting your opponent on a battle of the wits, you would actually think of something clever. And if that didn't work, while checking your replies, we would continuously play the sound of a chicken to remind you to not take yourself too seriously. In fact, I have it here. Let me see if I can get it going, if I can get my chicken up. Whoa, oh, there is my chicken. Let me see if I can get it here. And the volume up. So this is the Twitter app. When you pull to refresh, this is the sound that you get. So every time you pull to refresh. So that was the idea. Didn't work really well, but at least we put it in. So that's the idea. This is the app that we've been using. And the one thing to keep in mind is that it comes with the full unlinked Monotouch dialog. So it's a relatively large framework that is not linked. So keep that in mind because we're going to be talking about linking today. So this is the progress in kilobytes that we've made on the size of TweetStation since we started Xamarin. These are actually not include the Novell sizes because they were actually much larger. It's just that we couldn't get our hands on the old Xcode to actually do the builds. But you can see that we've been reducing the size of the application. What is interesting to know is the last two data points, the second to last, 6.2.1, is the currently released version of Monotouch. And 6.3.3.2 is the async version that just went live today. So we actually worked very hard to make sure that we did not regress in size. There's a tiny bit of a slope, a small, small slope there. So by compiling your code with the async version, that has an entirely new garbage collector, an entirely new virtual machine, and an entirely new set of class libraries, there is a little bit of a delta, but we're very happy that we haven't regressed that much in terms of size. As you can see, it is minimal. The change is almost minimal. And before we release, we'd like to bring that actually below. Now, one of the new features, and this is all released. Now, let me tell you about a feature that is available in beta. And this is a feature that we're very proud of. So when you're using native libraries in iOS, not the system libraries, when we use a third-party library, a component library, or some very popular iOS library that you found online, by default, all native code is linked in. So if you find a tasty little library that you want to use, and it's a 1 megabyte library, your executable will grow in 1 megabyte, even if you only use 30% of the functionality of the library, right? So we're effectively doing the equivalent of forced load. We have this new option called Smart Link. And what it does is it merges the functionality of the mono linker and the system linker, and the iOS system linker. What that means is that only the pieces that you touch from the native library will be included. Of course, the caveat, if you use smart linking and you're using an Objective-C library that likes to do dynamic stuff, because dynamic is cool, it's not going to work. So let me show you the savings. What you see in this graph are the various test samples that we have for native libraries in Xamarin. And the column on the left is the size as it shipped today. And the column on the right is a new version with smart link enabled. Now, the savings here are not very big because all of these test samples actually exercise a lot of the API. So if it's a big library, we try to have tests that cover a lot of it. So the gains are not going to be absolute, but they will be a lot bigger if you only use a fraction of the functionality. In terms of actual bytes, these are the savings that you can expect. So as you can see, in many cases, you get binaries that are 300K smaller. So that's a big deal. Now let's talk about runtime improvements. This is a big deal for us. One of the issues that you probably have seen with MonoTouch is that since MonoTouch has to do static compilation, we cannot, in certain cases, the compiler is unable to infer certain uses of generics, in particular generics with value types. You've probably seen this error, a handle exception, system execution engine exception, attempting to JIT compile method. You will see those errors when the compiler has been unable to detect that you were going to use a generic instantiation at runtime, and you happen to trip over that. So what we did is, and you'll notice that this only happens with value types. And the reason it only happens with value types is that generics code can actually be shared for reference types. I'll talk more about this in a second. But what's important is that with this new technology, we allow full link, we allow RX, the reactive frameworks, and we allow many generic rich applications to work out of the box that were previously problematic for people, or they manually had to invoke the methods or reference the methods to be compiled. So we take all of that pain away. Now, so that's the reason for the problem. So let's look at an example. Let's talk about the method list of t, the method add, and it takes as a parameter a t object. If t is a reference type, that means a string, a URI, a UI view, a dictionary, a list of something, that is called a reference type. And what is interesting about the reference types is that the code generated for list of a reference type is the same. The same code they use for a list of string is the same code they use for a list of URI. The compiler generates code that can deal with that. So it doesn't really matter. As long as the static compiler is concerned, they look the same. They look like a pointer, right? They look like a four-byte pointer on iOS, right? So that's how we share it. So it means that if you use a list of many different things, it actually only generates one version of list of that, right? So you might create 1,000 instances of lists. You will only get one as long as the reference types. But this story changes a little bit with value types. With value types, we actually have to generate one version for each one of those. And the reason is a byte consumes 1 byte, an int consumes 4 bytes, a long consumes 8 bytes, right? So if you create a list of ints, you really need storage for 4-byte values, for space that takes 4 bytes. If you're using a list of byte, you only need one byte, right? And that's why the compiler has to generate two different versions, the version for byte and the version for long. So like I said, today with reference types, you can share the same code for all reference types. And the, what we're enabling today is this. We're enabling value type to be shared. So we use a special technique when we compile code that allows value types to be shared in the same way that reference types are shared. Now, for performance reasons, what we're doing is we're keeping the original instantiations. We're keeping the list of end, list of byte, list of long that we detect. But we also compile a fallback mechanism in case we're unable to detect that particular instance. And the way that we do it is we generate code for a fat value type. That's the way that it works. So internally, the compiler handles it as if we had a very fat value type. And it generates code that basically copies a fat value type. Now, it comes at a cost because this feature basically generates a lot of code just in case the runtime was unable to detect this use. You can disable this feature if you pass that flag to the compiler. This is the actual cost of value type sharing. So I'm comparing that versus a previous sample. So if you're running into problems with JIT compiler errors, if you turn on this feature, you're going to pay about a 400 kilobyte difference for your code. So the space that you just saved with some of our optimizations, you're probably going to be losing it if you decide to use generic value type sharing. But the good news is that it will save you a lot of time. So if you're running into these issues and you don't have time to dig into the problem, there's a price that you have to pay, but you'll get your code running right away. All of this stuff is available on the beta today, and it will make your life simpler if you need that. Now let me take another optimization. This is something that we did this year. Previously, mono cryptographic stack. So whenever you use crypto either to encrypt data on your system, or whether you wanted to use HTTPS, right, to communicate with a remote server on a secure connection, or any other use of crypto, we used a pure C# implementation of it. So it's the same implementation that we use on Linux, on Mac, and on iOS and Android. And what we did in this past year is we replaced the cryptographic stack on iOS and Mac to use OSX's Common Crypto. Common Crypto is actually a hardware accelerated assembly language tuned set of implementations for symmetric encryption, so that's AES, DES, that sort of thing, and for hash functions. It doesn't do asymmetric, so it doesn't do RSA, but at least it does those two, symmetric and hash functions. It is also hardware accelerated, so there's special hardware on your device, on your iOS device, that will be hardware accelerated. It's kind of funny because this hardware accelerated feature, at least on my phone, only works when it's plugged. So if you plug your phone to the AC power, you'll see that the benchmarks actually go faster. I don't know why. And when you unplug it, iOS stops using the hardware. So I don't understand how that works, but there's something like that. What is interesting is that you save 100 kilobytes. So basically, we replace our entire managed implementation with a hand-tuned implementation. You save about 100K of space. This is released. The other thing that we want to talk about is the beta, like I mentioned, uses a new garbage collector. This is called the SGen. The S used to stand for simple. And today is no longer simple. Today is a very sophisticated generational, you know, split nursery, all generational, effectively three generation, multi-threaded garbage collector with thread-specific pools. And now we have concurrent garbage collections, so your application can keep running even while we're doing garbage collection in the background. We're finally enabling as a supported feature because it's no longer slower in any scenario than BOEM. So we're now at least as fast as BOEM, and in many cases, we're much faster. So in the general case, SGen is a lot faster. Now it's enabled on the beta channel. It's a precise garbage collector, so it's no longer a conservative collector. So that will help your system. It reduces the memory footprint of your applications. So it's available on the beta. Android has always used it, and now we're bringing SGen also to iOS. Now let's talk a little bit about APIs. Here are a couple of debugging aids that will help you build better applications. The first one is we introduced this year a property called description on NSObject. this property is equivalent, is the Objective-C equivalent of toString from C sharp. So it gives you a low-level rendering of the underlying object, of your underlying Objective-C object. The good news is that you get the benefits of this almost for free, because the NSObject2String call basically calls description. But in case that you override your toString, or in case that some of the methods in our implementation of the libraries overrides the string, you can always get to the underlying representation by calling description. This is already released. This is probably the most exciting piece that some of you have. Some of you run into this one recently. What happens is almost no UI toolkit. In fact, no production UI toolkit in this world is multi-threaded safe. What that means is that no toolkit can allow two threads to modify elements on the user interface. And the reason is that user interface toolkits are already very sophisticated pieces of software. Making them multi-thread safe just increases the complexity by order of magnitude. So effectively, no user interface toolkit on iOS, on Android, on Windows, on Mac, anywhere is multi-thread safe. The problem that this poses for programmers is that it's common for programmers to accidentally make a mistake, run some code in a thread, and then they accidentally invoke a UI method, right? And if you do this with most frameworks, they'll be silent about this mistake. What that does is that it can silently corrupt the state of your application. So your application can slowly be corrupted. In the best case, you get some innocuous corruption. In the worst case, you get a crash. And the worst case scenario is that you get a crash that it's impossible to debug. You don't know why it happened. Your customers complain. You complain. You can't find the bug. You test it 100 times, and it doesn't happen. But every 100 times that you test it, it happens, right? And this is happening just because you are accidentally modifying something that you shouldn't, right? You shouldn't have been doing that. So what we did with Monotouch is we figured, since we're binding everything in Objective-C and we're providing a projection, right, we are the gatekeepers between the C-sharp world and the Objective-C world. We introduced a system that effectively guaranteed that you would only call UIKit methods from the main thread, right? And it's funny, because the moment that we turned this on, we figured, there is no scenario in which calling UIKit from a background thread was safe. It never was, right? Apple tells you, don't do it. And if you do it, you'll corrupt the application, and you won't be able to track down the bug. You just won't be able. It's going to be very, very painful. So we decided to enable this thing. And almost immediately, a lot of you detected problems in your application. We got a lot of emails. It's like, well, this is breaking my application. It used to work. Well, no, it didn't used to work. You were just corrupting your app. Your app was silently going to fail in the future. Now, to prevent an uprising, a riot on the streets, we only made this the default during debug mode as of today. So as of today, if you build on debug mode, you'll get these thread safety checks. In the future, we'll enable that for everybody. But today, it's only in debug mode. If you compile in release mode, you're not going to get those warnings. You only get it on debug mode. And it was very interesting, because a lot of people immediately noticed that they were doing something wrong. In fact, my own tweet station had a bug, right? I never realized. I was like, oh, it's very convenient. I'll just update the label from the background thread. So I was updating some label from my background thread. I didn't notice it. As you refactor your code, as you're making changes to the code, accidentally this slips in, or you cut and paste some code from here to there. And next thing you know, you're accessing UI elements that you shouldn't be accessing. So this was actually very, very useful in tracking down bugs in our own applications. And it's found hundreds of bugs on your own application. So this is something that today Objective-C doesn't deliver. And it's a tool that you can really use. So a couple of things about how to use this thing. There's a property called UI application threat check for illegal cross-thread calls. So it's always enabled. It's always set to true. If you want to manually disable that feature, for God knows why you would do that, but if you want to do that at runtime, you can turn it off. Maybe because some intern wrote some code and you don't have time to rewrite it, so you're playing it risky. It's like going to Mexico and getting the tacos from the street, and it's like, yeah, I'm I'm from Texas and immune. So it's something like that. So what you need to know? What you need to know is that almost all the classes in UIKit are thread unsafe. You should not call them. And in fact, any UI view controller outside of UIKit is also not thread safe. There's a couple of things. You can, if you want to always use this feature, even in release mode, you can pass force thread check, and that will enable the thread checks even on your release builds. Or you can force to remove it on your debug builds if you want to. Not advised, but again, you might have a tough stomach. Here are the only thread safe APIs that you can call from a background thread. We actually had to put this together through perusing Apple's documentation, talking to Apple, watching a lot of videos from Apple where they said this is there or this is not there. It's actually not all documented in a single place, so we had to collect this from all around the world, all of these resources. These are the only things that you can call from a background thread: UI color, UI font, UI image, UI Bezier path, UI device. And interestingly enough, UI document, which is the foundation for iCloud. So if you're using iCloud, it turns out that you can use all of those features on the background. There's a couple of interesting methods that you can access that are thread safe. UI application, shared application, gets you to the main application. All the background APIs in UI application. So all of those APIs that you can say, hey, give me another 10 seconds to run, give me another 30 seconds to run, or give me or cancel a background task. You can use that. All the UI view drop methods. And in general, if you look at our documentation, anything that has a thread safe attribute, that's a good way of finding out. Can I call this thing? If it has a thread safe attribute, it means that you can do that. Now, this morning we talked about async. So async, it's on our beta channel. What we've done is we've implemented all of the async APIs that you find in .NET Framework 4.5. So everything in system, core lib, system XML, xDocument, all of this stuff. Our coverage for .NET 4.5 is complete for all async APIs. And then we've added about 114 methods to the beta that are monotouch specific. So a lot of the APIs that iOS exposed as a method that took some parameters and then a callback on completion, we've turned all of those into async methods, so you can await any of those things. We're going to be adding more of those. This is probably about a third of all the async methods that we're going to add. The other two-thirds are actually other styles of methods that don't necessarily follow that pattern. Things like NSData load from URI. So all of these APIs that iOS exposes that can take a long time to run, things like downloading data from the network, parsing data, we're going to make all of those async. So you can expect that during this beta process, we're going to add about another 200 methods. It's also very easy if you're binding native libraries to turn a native library into an async method. I'll talk more about that in our Objective-C bindings talk tomorrow. Now, one thing that is very interesting, and the question that we get a lot is, how do I know that async is going to do the right thing? So when you call await on a method, how do you know that this is going to do the right thing? Well, the way that it's going to happen is that actually the designers of .NET were really, really clever. There is this per-thread variable called the synchronization context. And the synchronization context essentially is what the compiler integrates with the synchronization context, and based on that variable, it determines where to resume execution, right? So you're running on the UI thread, and you make an await call. The code will resume on the same thread, well, on the same synchronization context that you executed. We've created a UIKit synchronization context. That means that if you ever await on the UIKit main thread, your code will resume execution when it completes on the UIKit main thread. That means that async just works. If you're running on a background thread on what Apple calls Grand Central Dispatch, if you're using a dispatch queue from Grand Central Dispatch, the await will resume execution on the same queue. So typically, those are used on things like video handlers, audio handlers, things that need to run on real time on their own separate thread with either a higher or lower priority. If you call await on those ones, execution will resume on that same queue. So we've integrated deeply with the Grand Central Dispatch. This is roughly what you can expect with the 114 methods that we have today. That is what it looks like. Whenever you see a method called void operation, it used to take one or zero or more parameters, and it had a callback for on completion. Now we also expose a task and method called operation with the suffix async, it returns the task, and it takes all the parameters. So that's a pattern that you're going to find on the beta. Now, let me take a little bit about other API improvements that we've done. In the last year, we've expanded our support for strong type constructors. Let me explain this. Really, the major benefit of using C#, I mean, well, not the main, but one of the major benefits of using C# over Objective-C is that you have a strongly typed API. And what that means is that when you're typing your code, you press dot, and you get code completion, right? So it's very easy to explore the API by writing methods dot. You see what you're looking for, dot, you see what you're looking for. And you don't really need to spend a lot of time going back and forth from the documentation, right? You need to say, well, what was this thing? What parameters does it take, right? Let me give you an example. One of the most common idioms in iOS is to pass an options dictionary to a lot of methods. So when you're looking at Objective-C API, you'll see in a lot of places that you're calling something like draw, you take X, Y, some string, and then options, right? Like what color it should draw with, should it be underlined, that sort of thing. And the problem is that creating a dictionary with these options actually relies on some well-defined constant names that you have to reference. And each constant name needs to have a proper type. If you get the constant wrong, the method silently ignores it, right? So if you pass something wrong, it just won't work. So it's very easy to introduce mistakes. If you don't use the right thing, it's going to stop working. If you get the wrong thing, it's not going to work. You never get an error message. You don't know what it is. It can become very frustrating. You have to go back and forth to the documentation and figure out what's happening there. Also, if the keys are the wrong types, you don't get that information. So what we did is we actually went and did the work for you. We went to every single NS dictionary in the API where this would happen. So you could use the NS dictionary option if you want, if you insist on. But what we did is we went through every one of those ones, and we figured out what the keys were and what the values were to ensure that what you get is a strongly typed API. So the way that you work is just say new whatever options, and then you get code completion, right? And you can see that in a lot of our APIs. So you immediately get code completion. You don't have to guess which keys are available. You don't need to guess what options are available or what data types are available. Code completion will do that work for you. So we've been doing all of that. That's the stuff that we did in the last year. There's a couple of nice nuggets. iOS doesn't provide an API to capture the screen. There's a couple of knowledge-based articles from Apple on how to do it. We did the work for you. So if you have a UI kit screen, just call UI screen capture. You get a screenshot. Or if you want to capture an OpenGL content, and you're building MonoGame or Cocos2D, call that API. You'll get a screenshot. We've also improved UI gesture recognizers. All of this, again, is released. It used to be, I don't have my mouse to hover over these things, but as you can see here, it used to be that you needed to use the low-level Objective-C selectors. It used to be that you needed to pass those selectors, create exports, and the problem is that you could accidentally pass the wrong parameter, that UI pan gesture recognizer. You could put anything there. It could be an NS dictionary, and the compiler wouldn't mind because you're using the loosely typed API, right? So that is the previous API. The new API, it's actually strongly typed. So you say new UI pan gesture recognizer, and it enforces that your callback, in this case pan image, will take the proper types, right? So using the new API, the one that doesn't use selector, if you see the word selector anywhere, is the old style and is the Objective-C loose type system. If you want to use a strong type, just avoid the word selector. That's the recipe. Avoid exports and avoid selectors. That's it. We've improved also UI appearance. We had a problem with UI appearance. We were very happy with our UI appearance API, but it had a problem. It worked great for built-in widgets, but it didn't work for subclasses. Now we just introduced a version that allows subclasses to work. So if you create your own subclass, that's what you will have to do. The change is very simple. So instead of calling custom slider.appearance, you call custom slider.getAppearance, and you're derived typed. That's all the only change that you have to do. All of this is in our documentation. We've also improved notifications. Notifications, like a lot of other things in Objective-C, are loosely typed. And again, you register loose types. You get dictionaries with loose types. You need to look up keys with loose types. You need to guess the values with loose types. And you have to do a lot of typecasting, a lot of guesswork, a lot of trips to the documentation. And it is quite painful. It is actually a lot of noise. You end up typing a lot of noise. You end up writing 30 lines of code just to get data out. So we fix that. We created a notification class, a nested notification class. And you'll see this pattern everywhere in Monotouch. For example, UI keyboard exposes notifications. And the way that you access it is the UI keyboard.notifications class. It's a nested class. And the pattern that you use is that you call the method observe XXX, where XXX is the property that you want to observe, and it returns an observer token. This observer token, if you call dispose on it, it will stop listening to the notifications, right? Let me show you what it looks like. This is what it looks like. I hope that you can see that. In this case, I'm observing the event when the keyboard on iOS is shown into the screen, right? That's a little event that gets shown. And notice that I'm saving the return value in the variable notification. That's what I'm going to use to when I want to stop receiving notifications. And the method that I declare there, the lambda, is dumping all the data. In this particular case, I want to show you that I'm accessing the strong types frame begin, frame end. Those are two rectangle Fs that describe where the rectangle was and where the rectangle is going to end up in the screen. It's also going to tell me what the duration of the animation is going to be for the keyboard to go up, right? So it's going to tell me what the timing is going to be. And it's also going to tell me what kind of animation curve it used, right? It can be linear, it could be smooth, it could do a little bounce, depending on how you configured it. So basically, you get all of this information as part of the notification to adjust elements in your user interface. You typically need to adjust your UI, maybe scroll some widgets, maybe adjust some things on the screen. And it used to be that this code was a mess of dictionaries and accessing keys, and it was buggy and so on. So we made it very simple. And again, when you want to stop listening, you just call notification dispose. NS attributed string is another one of those APIs that is very loosely typed, very, very powerful, but loosely typed. It was introduced in iOS 5 for a core text. And it didn't really matter in iOS 5 because very few people use Cortex. It's a very advanced API for doing typesetting. Most people just throw some widgets on the screen and they're done. But if you're doing high quality typography, you would use it. With iOS 6, though, it became the people's tool. Now, every element on UIKit, entries, labels, text fields, anything you can put some text on the screen can now take an attributed string. An attributed string lets you put fonts, colors in anything. So instead of just having some plain, boring labels, now you can have engaging presentations. So it's everywhere, and we need to do something about it because this was very cumbersome to create. It was very painful to use. It was just another one of those dictionaries with magic keys, with magic values. It's not advancing. Oh, there it is. So what you see on the top is the way that people used to create those things. That's typically how you would do it in Objective-C, and that's how you do it with older versions of Monotouch. You create these magic attributes, right? You need to get those are the magic keys, NS attributed string dot font attribute name. And then you needed to pass the right key, in this case, UI font from name. But there's nothing, IntelliSense couldn't do anything for you. I mean, this is just a dictionary, right? A dictionary just gets values. It didn't know what information was allowed, what is legal and what is not legal, what values are allowed and which ones are not. So very error-prone, very hard to debug, very obnoxious to use. So it's recompile until you get it running. Now we're using NS attributed string with C# style parameters. The way that you do it is you just say new NS attributed string, in this case, hello world, and I'm using C# name parameters. Notice what I'm doing there. I'm just saying, hey, I want to set the font. So I set font colon, code completion, UI font from name. I pass the name. And then I use foreground color colon, UI color red. And there's another 20 attributes that you can set. So basically, you can create NS attributed strings and get the benefits of strong typing. The other thing that we did, again, it's all released, Audio Toolbox, Audio Unix, and Core MIDI. I think that we've done a fantastic job with Core MIDI. If you're doing MIDI integration, our APIs are object-oriented, and they're beautiful. In fact, almost nobody can build Core MIDI applications and remain sane on iOS. In fact, most people end up using high-level wrappers, object-oriented wrappers in Objective-C that will give them a semblance of this. We're very happy that our API is actually even much higher level than this. It is much better than most of those wrappers in Objective-C. So it's very, very good. We now completely support all your Unix, so you can create every you can create your own GarageBand. You can do sampling applications. We have full API coverage. And we also expanded our support for multiple channel audio. So it used to be that we only supported two channels, that we could support multiple channels, you know, Dolby 5.1, all that stuff. And again, strongly typed APIs everywhere. On the beta, this is very, very exciting. As you guys know, .NET 4.5 brings an async HTTP stack. What is very interesting is that now we can, at your own leisure, you can create an HTTP client that doesn't use the .NET networking transport, but uses the Apple CF network transport. That has one big advantage. It automatically turns on the radio for you. In the past, you needed to turn on the radio yourself if you were on if you were using the .NET APIs. And the way that you did it is the thing that even your phone says that it says 3G. Typically, that has not connected to a remote server, so you needed to start the modem. Basically, you needed to start the connection. So you would call this method, it will start the connection, and then you could make your network API call. When you use Apple CF network, it will automatically wake up the modem, it will make the connection, and then you'll be able to get it. So all you need to do to use this new functionality is replace, and we'll make it a configuration option before we release, but today you can use it by replacing the call to new HTTP client, replace it with new HTTP client, new CF network handler. And now you'll be using Apple's underlying network stack. It has a couple of other benefits. It automatically goes through Apple's proxy system, so it handles every possible proxy scenario, and it handles VPN for you as well. So this is in the beta. We also, some of you might be very happy to know that we changed the dispose semantics about 2 months ago on NSObjects. What it does is that now when you call dispose on an object, we don't actually dispose it. We just flag it as is, as in when the native world stops using it, actually do the dispose. And this has the effect that now you can register all of your managed objects with the Objective-C world and forget about them and let Objective-C manage them. It's already released, so if you had a bug in the past, now it's solved. You don't need to know about that, but it's very good. The next thing that I want to talk to you about, it's Razor integration. This is probably one of those things that people haven't heard about. What is fascinating about this is that in many cases, you're going to want your native application to display some HTML content. There's some HTML content that you want to render, or either you want to build a server application that displays some stuff to the client, or you want to display some stuff in the UI. So in the past, the way that you build that is you create a string builder, or you did console write lines, or file write line, and you would dump your HTML, and then you would load it into the web control. And that is kind of cumbersome. We've integrated Razor into MonoDevelop. That means that you can write Razor code to generate all of your UI web view controls. And you can blend C# code and your HTML code and JavaScript in the same view. So if you want to use jQuery, if you want to use Sencha, and you just cannot stomach having to do manual templating, you can now use Razor. Let me show you how you do it. You go to Xamarin Studio, you choose New File, Text Template Razor. That's all you have to do. Then, let's say that you, in this particular case, I called my my template HTML report right there. So I called that HTML report. You can barely see it. I'm sorry. And what you do is you say var template equal new HTML report, my template that I created. That is a Razor file. You pass some data to it. And this is the data that you can access from Razor. And then just to generate it, all you have to do is call either one of these two methods. Generate string will generate a string that you can dump directly into UI web view. Or you can generate a text file, and you provide your own text writer, and that will be generated. Thank you very much. So I can't see anything. So if you have a question, you're going to have to yell. Yes?
I have a question related to Azure. And if you want to call JavaScript, and we want to import the external JavaScript library, how does it work with that?
So the way that you would do it, the simplest way to integrate third-party, if you have an existing HTML app and you want to integrate it here, you copy-paste your HTML, you rename your HTML files as CSHTML. That's it. That will run automatically. Now, the next step is to actually spice it up, because now you got your JavaScript in there. Now you want to probably pass some data from C# to your Razor file. So what you do is you use this at sign in Razor. So you start replacing your Razor file. You start using the at sign. And then the next piece of code is C# code. There's a whole session dedicated to Razor that's going to be done by Ryan Paul. I think it's tomorrow. So it's a session called doing hybrid applications. And he'll go through all of this there. Yes?
I'm just wondering if there's any reason not to move to the beta channel and use Mono Trioso. For instance, is it backwards compatible with existing 2.8 libraries? So if I upgrade my application to the new beta, can I still use, say, RestSharp, Newton.json, and all that stuff?
They should all work. I don't know of any reason why they wouldn't work. I would say that I use the beta all the time, but I would be lying. What happens is that I have to test the stable version, so I install the alpha and the, you know, the stable and the beta and the alpha about every day. I have to reinstall all of them. So, but I use it every day. I use it every day. Just don't have it all the time on my machine.
Hey there. With all the Xamarin Cloud stuff today, which is fucking brilliant, it really is. That got me thinking. With having to have a Mac for when you're working in Visual Studio, is there some kind of cloud Mac thing? There must be some potential for doing some cloud Mac-y thing for doing your build without having a physical Mac now.
Right. There are services like that that you can certainly try. We don't use those. But realistically, growing up in the open source world, you become a licensing and copyright nerd, right? So if the license says you can't do it, for example, it says this software can be used for everything, but you can't smile. So we're very respectful. So when we use the software, we don't smile. So what that means is that generally, we respect the license and the wishes of creators to the letter, because we're open source people. So we're very, very pedantic about licenses. At least I am. In this particular case, Apple says that if you want to do iOS development, you should have a physical Mac next to you. So our position when it comes to Visual Studio and Mac development is you should have a Mac next to you, because that's what the license says. The other thing to keep in mind is that even if you were to be able to do a development on the cloud, it's kind of obnoxious. It is actually really obnoxious to send simulator and images and your game images constantly down the network. And how are you going to plug it? Or, you know, it becomes very messy. So personally, I don't think it's very good. But also, Apple doesn't like it. So we actually don't do anything to enable that, because why bother? Apple doesn't like it. So why even waste the effort? So we'd rather fix other things than do that.
You guys just released the iOS designer. And MVVM is very interesting subject in the iOS and Android. Do you have like a future plan to embrace the MVVM, like a UI data binding and the data templates to do like natively support in your iOS design and Android design?
Well, like I said today in the keynote, whenever it comes to, it would really be a good idea if you guys did this. Our approach to that is, if it's a really good idea, we will do it. And it's definitely a good idea. So I don't have anything to share right now, but we want to get there. We really like MVVM Cross, just like Scott Hanselman really likes it. We really like it. PCL support, like he said, is coming. We were not prepared to announce it this morning, because we missed the cutoff date by 2 weeks. So the code was almost there, but QA said, we need to QA now. You can't change the bits anymore if you want to release something for the conference. So that's it. They actually run the company. QA runs the company. So we got the code. We just couldn't land it on time. So expect PCL to be supported in about a month, roughly. And at that point, you'll see more things come together in terms of MVVM Cross, in terms of sharing libraries. It's a shame we could announce it this morning, but it's coming. It's coming. PCL is coming.
Is it likely you'll support Windows Phone development on a Mac?
are we going to support Windows Phone development in Mac? It's a very rare scenario. We don't currently have plans. The way that we see things, it's a great idea. And like I said before, Xamarin would do anything that is a great idea. But on the other hand, Xamarin also has to evaluate what will give us the most bang for the buck, right? So we have a great team of people, and the question is, how can we make the world a better place with this team that we have? And while it's a good idea, it will be a distraction to support Windows Phone development on the Mac, because most people doing Windows Phone development probably want to do it in Windows, where they would get designers that will have all the support from Microsoft that already supports it natively. So it's a good idea, but I don't think we're going to do it. The one thing that we're going to do is we're going to let you open solutions that include Windows Phone projects. We're not going to compile them, but we're going to let them load that. You're going to be able to get code completion and everything, but we're not going to try to do deploy, debug, any of that. All right, well, thank you very much, everybody. Let's go get the coffee.